Hey, good morning and welcome. If you're visiting with us, we are especially glad that you're here. We ask that you hang around for a few moments after the services. Let us get to know you, greet you, perhaps find out if we can serve you in some way. Additionally, if you're visiting, you'll notice some visitors' cards. If you're willing, please fill those out. We'd like to have a record of your visit. Pass those toward the center, and the ushers will be by in just a few moments to pick those up. Next time of service will be this afternoon at 5, and we hope that you have already planned on being here and work that into your schedule. Don't forget the service team sheet, as always, just outside the door. Get that on your way out. Use that during your daily Bible reading. That's an excellent tool to, as a prayer reminder of who to ask the Father for. Running down the list real quick, Betty Wisant, Wahila Hala, Jim and Nancy Long. Don't forget these people. Don't forget the people who have had losses. The Kilpatrick family, Arlene on... the brother Bobby Chandler, and also Arlene and George's aunt B.B. Stiles, so don't forget that family. Also, don't forget a local family, James and Julie Sear, who lost their son Nick this past week. Ugly Christmas party tonight. Ugly Christmas sweater party. I would do good at that party, wouldn't I? Ugly Christmas sweater party tonight after services, so young people, teen and college, don't forget that. New Year's lock-in is coming up. See the sign-up sheet if you're interested in that. The fruit baskets. The fruit baskets will be assembled this afternoon. And if you put someone's name on the list, as always, you're responsible for delivering that. If you come in this evening, Mike says, where you sit, he knows who put names on the list, where you sit will be the fruit basket for you to deliver. So if you come in and see that, that's for you to take care of. Otherwise, you can see Mike or go in the back and pick up the fruit basket. But that'll be this evening. Ushers, if you'll please pick up any cards. Our first song this morning is going to be song 236, song 236. Presley Campbell will have our opening prayer. Brother Kyle Traylor will have our closing. Glad that you're here, Brother Presley.
Please pray with me as we go to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today in prayer. We come to you and praise you as our Creator, praise you as the Creator of all that is around us. Our Father, we thank you for all you have blessed us with. We pray that each of us will think of this each day of our lives and appreciate all that you have done for us. Our Father, we thank you for allowing us to live in a place, in a country that allows us to meet without persecution. We realize that there are places in this world that do not have that. Thank you, and we ask that you give each of us strength to promote this freedom to worship you in the world in the future. Our Father, we thank you for your word. We pray as we study it today that you will give us the correct understanding, that you will enable us to have the courage to use what you have told us in your word to give the world your message. Our Father, we also in this respect, we realize that we do sin. We thank you for the sacrifice that Christ made for us, and that at this time we ask that you will forgive each of us of our sins. We ask that you will give us the strength to continue to try to live the life that is acceptable to you. Our Father, we have the leadership of this church that gives time themselves, and we pray that you will continue to bless them to have the wisdom to promote your word, your will, and give them the strength in times in which they're tired to continue on. Our Father, as we approach you in this worship of song and remembering of the sacrifice that Christ did for us, that you will accept all this that we are about to do. We ask that you will continue with us in this worship service. These things we do pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Please join me in song this morning. 236 will be our first one. We'll do the first, third, and the fifth stanzas, please.
I found my Lord, and He is mine. He won me by His love. I'll serve Him all my years of time, and dwell with Him above. His yoke is easy, His burden is light. I found His soul, I found His soul. His service is my sweetest delight, His blessings ever flow. He's dearer to my heart than life. He found me lost in sin. He calmed the sea of inward strife and made me come. I found His soul, I found His soul. His service is my sweetest delight, His blessings ever flow. I tried the road of sin and found its prospects all deceived. I prove the Lord and joys abound more than I could believe. His yoke is easy, His burden is light. I found His soul, His soul, His service is my sweetest delight, His blessings ever flow.
Very good. 436, nearer still, nearer. We'll do the first and the second stanzas, please.
Nearer still, nearer, close to thy heart. Draw me, my Savior, so precious thou art.
Salvation, actually, and we commemorate that this morning as we assemble to partake of the bread and the fruit of the vine representing his body and his blood. We know this was given for us at Calvary by Jesus and provides us the salvation that we enjoy today and the hope of salvation with him in heaven. We'll sing the first and the second stanzas before we partake of his memorial this morning.
My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for being able to gather around this table as Christians. Lord, we thank you for your Son coming and dying that cruel cross, a cruel death upon the cross. We do love you, and we thank you for that. And we pray that as we partake this loaf that represents his body, that we may look back to the cross and understand the love that he had for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Father, at this time, we're thankful for this cup and what it represents, for the crucifixion, the scourging, the blood that poured from Christ's body. And we're thankful for that blood and what it represents and the salvation we have when this life is over. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Nine hundred sixty-one. In ancient times, you know from reading the books, we didn't live then, but if you got permission to go in front of the king, not everyone did get permission, but if you did, you were able to bring normally a gift. You gave a gift to the king when you got to see him, and then carried on with your business. And in some fashion today, I think we should think about our opportunity to visit with the Lord here on Sunday and to come in his presence. We also think about our gift today, our monetary gifts that we give back to his cause, as was demonstrated in New Testament Christianity. But again, just to show our submission and our acknowledgement to him that all is his, we bring our gifts this morning as we give back to God and hopefully commit our lives in such a way, as this song indicates, to give him holy praise with what we have. Let's sing this before we get back.
On bended knee I come, with a humble heart I come, bowing down before your holy throne, lifting holy hands to you as I pledge my love anew. I worship you in spirit, I worship you in truth. Make my life holy praise unto you.
Mm-hmm. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the many blessings that you bestow upon us. We're thankful now for this time that we have to lay by in store. We pray that you will bless this offering, that it be used to glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please mark number 107. 107 will be our song after the lesson this morning. And now 571 is Seeking the Lost. We'll do the first and the second stanzas. If you'd like to, please stand and join me in this.
Seeking the lost, yes, kindly entreating, wanders on the mountain astray. Come to me, his message repeating, words of the Master speaking today.
Going afar,
upon the mountain,
bringing the
wander back again,
into the fold.
Of my Redeemer,
Jesus the Lamb,
for sinners slain, seeking the lost and pointing to Jesus, souls that are weak and hearts that are sore, leading them forth in ways of salvation, showing the path to life evermore.
Going afar,
upon the mountain,
bringing the
wonder back again,
into the fold
of my Redeemer.
Jesus the Lamb, for sinners slain.
Be seated, please.
If you're visiting with us, we're thankful for your presence. If you're not visiting with us, we're thankful for your presence. We're glad that you're here this morning. We do have visitors with us. We're thankful that you've come. We hope to meet you. Some are visiting family, some from our neighborhood and community. We're grateful for you being here, and we hope that your time with us this morning will be profitable. There used to be a show that came on television way back when we only had three channels, and it would come on and it'd mess up the screen, and it said, "Do not attempt to adjust your signal. We control the vertical. We control the horizontal." And for the whatever period of time, they're in control. Well, some of you are sitting in the back right now and you're probably saying, "I can't hear." Well, we know. Our sound system is still on the underway with some modifications. Part of our unit is out. We've got a loaner in, and the guys are making adjustments as best they can, but everything's not working. We know it. Sorry about that. If you sit closer in the auditorium, you will hear better. We'll try to... This is not a backhanded move to try to get you out of the back rooms, but those speakers are not working, so the farther up you sit, the better you're going to hear, but I'll try to make sure that you get to hear me. Much of life that we spend our time about is what I might describe as the little thoughts. We're trying to get through today. We manage our activities right now, what it takes for us to do each day, but we're also capable of big thoughts, of thinking past the here and now to what will be larger than us, sometimes bigger than life. The big thoughts sometimes it takes us into what I describe as wow country, where there is an awareness or a significance to what we think that causes our response inside to be sometimes overwhelming, that we're surprised or we have trouble grasping the grandeur of everything. Big thoughts might include, who am I? Why am I here? What is my purpose? What am I doing with my life? Things of that sort can capture our imagination or our attention. Or it may be that you find yourself sitting outside on some summer evening, looking up at a summer sky with the stars filling everything, with maybe a moon out that captures your imagination, and you just sit and you look and you think about what you're seeing and how big the universe is and the world that we live in and all of the stars and all of the creation, and you just go, wow. Psalm 19, verse 1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. The psalmist in Psalm 19 says, we look up at the sky and you see those stars and you see the handiwork of God. You see what God has done. And day after day, night after night, you go out and you observe these things. And he says, there's not any language, there's no tongue, there's no place where that message is not heard. Every person, every inhabitant of the world can go out and see the majesty of God's creation, the world around us, the stars in the sky. And it's been going on. Their speech. It doesn't matter what language you speak. It doesn't matter if you have no language. This testimony from the sky cuts across all barriers. The topic of speech. You know, here we are. You are listening to me, but as I am speaking, it's an amazing thing. Human speech. Just the concept, the idea, it is so complex. The fact that a human being can have a thought, and that thought can be turned into an intent. And then that intent forms itself in a very complex process. Physiologists tell us that there are 75 plus human muscles that must be brought into play in order for human speech to do what we do without really thinking. We form the words, we form the sounds, we articulate those ideas. And then as we say those words, as we speak words into the air, And other people then hear those words, and the process is reversed. Those words are translated into ideas and into thoughts. And so that one human being can share the thinking that they have with another human being by speech. The writer of Psalms says God is speaking. Here is God's message, and we receive it. Now add another thought to that. Add God to the concept of speech. And if we see the stars and we see the sky, and the psalmist said that shows or demonstrates God's handiwork, what if God spoke? And so we didn't just see the events or circumstances, but we heard the words, we heard the thoughts of God. Would that be amazing? When was the last time you read through Genesis chapter 1? 10 times in Genesis chapter 1 alone, the scriptures record for us, God said. God said. The fact of God speaking is a wow moment. And when we look at Genesis chapter 1, all of the creation events are driven by that phrase. God said, let there be light, and there was light. God said, let the land be gathered together, and it happened. God said, and each step through the creation, as we go through Genesis chapter 1, where God is speaking, God speaking into existence the things that we see. You know what happens when I speak? Well, it depends on where I'm at. Some people go to sleep. I had a lady years ago told me that the best thing to put her baby to sleep is a tape of my sermon. Outstanding. Pop that puppy in there and just let them baby sleep. I've seen some adults that use that methodology. Nothing happens when I speak. It makes sound. You hear it, other people hear it. But I could say to this bench right here, bench, get up and move. You know what's going to happen? Nothing. The bench is going to stay there. Now, I might coerce, embarrass, or humiliate one of you fine folk into doing something for me. But I have no power of speech. And so when we read back in Genesis chapter 1, God said, and just the sound of his words, just his speech, caused things to come into creation. That's a wow moment. God said, and the world came into being. There are 4 images of some men on Mount Rushmore. I was reading from a guy who was talking about the uniqueness of our existence and the power of God. And he brought up this as an illustration. And he said, here's Mount Rushmore, and suppose you go to Mount Rushmore and you're standing there looking at it, and that's in South Dakota, right? The Black Hills. And you're standing there, and you say to the crowd who's maybe standing around, you know, it's interesting the way that erosion has formed that mountain, don't you think? The way the sun and the rain and the wind has eroded away that mountainside so that it kind of resembles and looks like people there. And if folks stand around you go, what are you talking about? Are you crazy? Those faces did not occur naturally. Those were carved. That's the work. Don't you know anything? You can tell by looking that somebody has carved out that mountain to look like a person. Really? Are you sure about that? Absolutely sure. Well, how about that? The image of a human being carved on the side of a mountain, people are absolutely certain did not come about by chance and accident. They know that that represents the action of a creator. But the person and the people who are the representatives of what that mountainside has copied, people say, now that occurred by accident. Isn't that interesting? God said, and all of these things came into being. Not God not only spoke into the creation, but God also spoke concerning who he was. There are several passages we could go back and read from. Exodus chapter 3, verse 6. Abraham, I'll get my mind around my tongue in a moment, or vice versa. Moses, in asking God about who he is, says, what am I going to tell the people when they ask who you are? And God says, you tell the children of Israel, I am what I am. Start reading with me, verse 13, Exodus 3. Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, did you read that? You with me in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14? And God said to Moses, God spoke. And here's what he said. I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Moreover, God said to Moses, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations. God said, and creation happened. God said and told Moses, here's my name. In fact, God said everything there is about life. We have looked often at Hebrews chapter 1, the first two verses. It would be worthy of our time to go and read it again, but I'll just make reference to it. I won't go and read it. It says in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, that in the times that were past, God spoke through the prophets to the fathers. God spoke to the fathers in various ways. He spoke through prophets. He spoke through dreams. He spoke through visions. And then he goes on in verse 2 and says, but God has spoken now through his son. God spoke. God spoke in time past, and he spoke all about how the children of Israel should live, their life, what they were going to do. Deuteronomy chapter 5. We're not going to read all of the things that would be pertinent to our discussion this morning, but I want to read a couple. Deuteronomy chapter 5, starting in the first verse. And Moses called all Israel and said to them, hear, O Israel, the statutes and judgments which I speak in your hearing today, that you may learn them and be careful to observe them. The Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb. Moses says, God has made an agreement with us. We have had the instruction from God concerning life, and here's how we should live, and this is what God said regarding it. And then the details flow out of that, and the specifics, beginning in verse 6. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Verse 7, you shall have no other gods before me. Verse 8, you shall make for yourself no carved images. Verse 11, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Verse 12, observe the Sabbath day to keep it holy. On down through the end of the chapter, each of these places, what God said. Chapter 6, verse 1, now this is the commandment, and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them. God told them about life, how they should live, what they should do. I want to make one New Testament application to this before we leave that thought. And if you'd like to follow along, I'm going to be reading from the 12th chapter of the Gospel of John. John chapter 12, starting in verse 37. John 12, 37. But although he had done so many signs before them, they did not believe in him, that the word of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spoke, "Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" Therefore they could not believe, because Isaiah said again, "He has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart, lest they should see with their eyes, lest they should understand with their hearts, and turn so that I should heal them." These things Isaiah said when he saw his glory and spoke of him. Nevertheless, even among the rulers many believed in him, but because of the Pharisees they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. For they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. Now keep reading as we come into Jesus' comments. Then Jesus cried out and said, "He who believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me. And he who sees me sees him who sent me. I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. And if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I do not judge him. For I do not come to judge the world, but to save the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his commandment is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak." Jesus said, God spoke the things of life, and Jesus passed them along. God said. Secondly, let's observe God saw. God saw. We could go back to Genesis chapter 1, 10th verse, and it says, "And God saw that it was good," following the creation. Go down a little farther, verse 12. "And God saw that it was good." Verse 18. "And God saw that it was good." Verse 21. "And God saw that it was good." Verse 25, "And God saw that it was good." You see, God was not only speaking, God was seeing. He was observing the things that were taking place there. God saw. Genesis chapter 4, God has a conversation with Cain. God says to Cain, "Where is your brother?" And Cain says, "Am I my brother's keeper?" And then God says, "Does not his blood cry out to me?" You see, God knew that Cain had killed his brother Abel. God saw these events as they unfolded. God knew what had taken place. God saw other things as well. There's a statement made concerning the sight of God in Genesis chapter 6. Now, you know that Genesis chapter 6 records the beginning of what we describe as the flood and the events around it. But listen to this reading from Genesis chapter 6, verse 5. "Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, 'I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing, and birds of the air, for I'm sorry that I've made them.' But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." God not only spoke, God saw. When God saw the evil of the world. God saw wickedness. God saw a world that was full of sin, and he determined to destroy it. But it also says that God saw Noah. God not only saw the evil, God also saw what was good. In chapter 6, verse 18, God says, "I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons with you." Why was God going to establish a covenant with him? Why was God going to establish a covenant only with these persons? Well, if we keep reading, we're going to find God speaking to Moses, speaking to Noah about his experiences. It says, I have seen you and your righteousness. God saw good. When God looked at Israel, what did he see? God saw the actions of Israel. When God saw David, what did he see? God saw the actions of David. In some ways, David was great. God calls him a man after his own heart. In other ways, David was despicable. And the events that unfold in 2 Samuel chapter 12, as Nathan the prophet comes before God, says, the man who has done the things you've done deserves to die. God saw it. But God saw more than just those things. And we need to jump forward in time to see some other things that God saw. And I want to just reference a couple. The first is in Matthew chapter 3. As we have the early discussion and story regarding the life of Jesus, the 15th verse shows Jesus requesting of John the Baptist to be baptized. John doesn't want to do so, but finally he allows it to happen. He says, permit it to be so for now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he allowed him. Now verse 16, Matthew 3. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. God saw Jesus. God saw his Son. And he was pleased in him. In fact, God saw the Son that was going to come long before the Son was here on the earth. In the prophet Micah, chapter 5, and the second verse, Micah's prophecy is to Bethlehem. And he says, you, Bethlehem, are among the thousands of Judah. But from you shall come the one who will rule forever. And then he says, and his beginning has been from the beginning. He who has come forth to me has been here from the ages. In Micah chapter 5, verse 2, the prophet was told to prophesy unto the people that God was preparing for himself to bring forward a ruler. That ruler would come from Bethlehem. That ruler would be the king over Israel. That ruler would have been one who came from ever, from all times, and would be forever. And he was speaking of Jesus. God said, God saw. Number three, let's talk about God sent. There are a whole lot of things we could look to in Scripture that would describe God sent. God sent Moses to Israel. We referenced some of that in Exodus chapter 3. And in fact, in that we get all three of those things. We have God who is speaking, and God who is sending, and God who is seeing all at the same time. God saw Israel, God saw Moses, God speaks to Israel, and he says, I am sending you to take care of these people and this problem. God sent Abraham to the promised land in Genesis chapter 12, and that relationship will continue for some time. God sent the prophets. The prophets throughout all of the Old Testament were sent by God. They did not carry themselves, but they did the things God required of them. I'll just pick one reference for us to read from to prove this point. Jeremiah chapter 7, start reading with me in verse 1. Jeremiah 7:1. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all you of Judah who enter at these gates to worship the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Do not trust in these lying words saying the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. For if you thoroughly amend your ways and your doings, if you thoroughly execute judgment between a man and his neighbor, verse 7, then I will cause you to dwell in this place in the land that I gave to your fathers forever. Drop down a little farther. Down to verse 13. Verse 12. Go now to my place which was in Shiloh, where I set my name at the first, and see what I did to it because of the wickedness of my people Israel. And now, because you have done all these works, says the Lord, and I spoke to you, rising up early and speaking, but you did not hear. And I called you, but you did not answer. Now drop down a little bit more. Drop down to verse 22. For I did not speak to your fathers or command them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings. But this is what I commanded them, saying, obey my voice, and I will be your God, and you shall be my people, and walk in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well with you. Yet they did not obey, nor incline their ear, but followed the counsels and the dictates of their evil hearts, and went backward, not forward. Since the days of your fathers came out of the land of Egypt, until this day, I have even sent to you all my servants, the prophets, daily rising up early and sending them. Yet they did not obey me or incline their ear, but stiffened their neck. They did worse than their fathers. You see, God, when he looked at the Old Testament world and he saw these people, he saw Israel and he saw Judah. And he saw the wickedness. He also saw goodness. And then he sent. He sent the prophets. He sent the men to testify of God's will and God's ways. And all of these messages were carried. And yet they did not follow. We could carry ourselves back to Genesis chapter 19. Where God sent fire and brimstone on the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. We could carry ourselves back into Genesis chapter 6 and read the story that follows there, and we could see where God sent the flood on the world that existed at that time. But I want to conclude in another direction. God not only sent the prophets, God not only sent destruction, God also sent his son. Hebrews chapter 1, first two verses. He spoke through the prophets of old, but now he speaks to us through his son. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. The writer of the book of Galatians, the apostle Paul, describing the relationship of God to the world, says, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born under the law, born of a woman, to redeem those who were under the law, so that they might receive the adoption of sons. Now, as God has revealed that to Paul, Paul's revelation is God saw the world, God spoke to the world, and now God has sent his son to the world for the express purpose of bringing that world back to him in redemption. Now think about that for a moment. Creator of the world, who had the power to speak all things into existence, not only spoke the world into existence, and not only spoke his will to the people in the world, but then sent his son into the world to live, to die to bring us back. The Creator God, everything we see around us, God created. The seeing God, everything we do, everything that exists, God sees. In fact, Jesus would say, not a sparrow falls to the ground except that my Father knows it. Matthew chapter 10, verse 29. The speaking God. When Paul would talk to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, he would say, all Scripture is inspired of God. All of the things that we read, they're the words from God. But most importantly for our time this morning, God is also the sending God who sent us the message, who sent us the Son, who sent us the hope of eternal life. One of the songs that we sing from time to time speaks of our worship. Oft we come together. We sing, we pray. And the chorus of that song says, help us, Lord, thy love to see. May we all, in truth and spirit, worship thee. The person who understands the Creator who brought the world into existence, the creator who spoke all things to begin, who spoke to mankind, the Creator who saw and sees all that exists, and finally the Creator who sent into our existence, our world, our lives, the opportunity for us to have a relationship with Him through forgiveness of our sins. That should bring us to a place of awe and wonder and worship. And God is still speaking. Through the invitation of Christ, Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon me. Learn of me. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. This morning, have you come to the place where God is? Have you come to where you have found and received the message that Jesus sent? The prophets who prophesied, the Son who came to bring salvation. Are you a part of that salvation this morning? The invitation of Christ is always extended. The message that was to be preached throughout the world, that Jesus Christ, the Son, had come, had died, had risen so that our sins could be washed away. And those who would believe that testimony, who would respond in obedient faith, would confess the name of Jesus, would change their lives in repentance, would be baptized for the remission of sins. It may be this morning that you need to do those things as well. If you're in this audience this morning and you need to respond in obedience to the Lord's call, we invite you in a moment as the song is sung that you will walk forward, that you'll confess before this audience your faith in Jesus, and even this morning put on the Lord in baptism. It may be you are a child of God but not faithful and need to come home. The invitation of Christ is to you. If this morning we can assist you spiritually, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
Number 68, we'll do the first stanza of this song as our closing song this morning, then be led in prayer. We thank you again for visiting, if that's the case. And we don't mention this every Sunday, it seems like, but we need to remind ourselves that it hadn't been going on long. The pew packers that Ryan works with, the young kids, and get the parents to bring them, they'll have a chance to sing in song before at 4:45 this afternoon before our worship at 5. Do the first stanza of this and then be dismissed in prayer.
God sent his son, they call him Jesus, he came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon, and him degraded to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Heavenly Father, thank you for a wow morning here at Maysville. We pray that we will never take these gatherings of the church for granted. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.